Hello and welcome to episode 44 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. We hope you're enjoying our conversations. We always like our guests to be interested in the conversation, and we hope you also find the same conversations interesting. Please give us your feedback, subscribe to our channel. I don't know whether I should say we should click that ring, click that bell, which all the YouTubers seem to say. But obviously, if you have a podcast application, you subscribe to that and give us a star rating on it if you like our podcast. That helps us other people understand whether you like our stuff or not. And as usual, we have a great panel of guests. We have Kumaran, who is the CTO and chief mentor for Tiny Magic. We have Venkat, who is the CTO and head of technology for Aqua Connect, which is a shrimp startup. I don't know how to say that, but it's a aquaculture startup, right? So, and Nishant, who is an architect at IBS Software, who has great experience developing and running architecting software. So today we have an interesting topic related to something which has just happened in the market based on what Microsoft released as a product called Cloud PC or Windows 365, right? So this is not really a discussion specifically about that product per se, but to try to understand how this matters to the people who Microsoft is trying to target, and customers in general, how will they find this useful? One is that this product is targeted at businesses, so this is not a product which is targeted at individual users as such, right? So we do not know whether that individual user products will come in the future, but presently, what it is targeted as is as a business user. So Kumaran, what do you think is the impact for you as a smaller organization? What would you like to see this development as?
I think it's very exciting because I've been trying to skin this cat for past couple of years. The scenario goes like most of my team, right? I would say 80% of my team are Mac users. Especially when and I'm a Windows user, I didn't have any problem till the past 2 years. But in the past 2 years, what has happened is we started moving on to Microsoft 365. That's one part. But then there was also other things like, for example, if you wanted to do RPA, okay, so UiPath, the client was on Windows. It's not there on Mac. Okay. Similarly for Power Automate, okay, or the Power BI desktop. All these are tools which is there only on the Windows desktop. So that came up with a very unique situation that if I wanted my team to use these applications, I needed a Windows machine. Now I've left with 2-3 choices. One, buy all of them an auxiliary Windows machine. Okay. What's the problem with fundamental problem? One is it's too much of capital expense. The bigger problem as a CTO, which I would see, is there's no return on investment. Like probably once a day in a month or 2 days in a month, they would use it. Okay. So then how will I get return? And then there is things of maintaining it, patching it. Like once in a month, they will switch it on. It's patching itself will run for some 1 hour kind of a thing. That will be a problem. It's too much space. It's too much of a hassle. Then the other thing which I thought of is, okay, why don't I have a machine provisioned on the cloud and give it to each of them? But then for that, I had to go get an Azure subscription for that. No, this is different from a normal business subscription. I had to get an Azure subscription, allocate a machine, go there and then install it and then give them an RDP and to do that. The management part of it was pretty expensive. Okay. And I had to switch on the machine, switch it off. Somebody has to switch it on. I have to tell them, you know, make sure you switch it on, make sure you switch it off. Otherwise, you'll run too much of a cost like that. In that scenario, I think finally there is this Spot VM which I chose for that, which is basically, it kind of, it's not that critical, right? It will move it out when it is not needed. So that pricing kind of helped for that. So I think, so when somebody wants, they can spin it off. But then I have to teach, I have to educate them on what Azure is, Azure subscription is, how to look at the Azure portal so that they can bring that VM up. So it's something like go there. Imagine I'm actually telling a process person in my thing. I'm telling him this is Azure portal. I have to assign, give them access to the Azure portal. Then I say, go to the Azure portal. You will find the VM here. Don't switch on this dev VM. Switch on the RPA VM. Switch it on. After you have done it, make sure that you close it.
So not worth the time investing.
It was getting too complicated. And then they might forget it. Then I had put an auto shutdown at 7 p.m. Now, if they're working on that, they will have to cancel it. It's like too messy, right? I couldn't quite take off. Then parallelly, I started looking at something called Parallax. Okay. So Parallax is installed on top of
Mac OS.
Mac, and you can run other OSs on that. Either you do that or you put something like, I even forgot what the Sun had a virtual machine
virtual PC.
Virtual PC was from Microsoft. Sun
VMware, had some, right? It's a sorry. VMware.
No, okay. Sun had its own thing, right?
VMware got acquired by Sun, but there was another thing.
So VMware, by the way, is part of Dell now. Dell owns VMware.
Okay. So then again, installing that on a Mac machine and running a VM on top of that, again, it's too complicated. So we're just trying this out, never caught weight anywhere. But when I saw this, I think this was like very good for what I would need. So basically, it's a perfect thing for me. Now I have two options, either for all the... So what I'm thinking as of now, I will use this is, I would have one machine for the tech team, one machine for the process team. Mm-hmm. It's anyway going to be shared. Mm-hmm. So it will be the same machine, but they can log in with different credentials. Mm-hmm. And whatever software has to be installed, I will install it only once. Mm-hmm. With different login IDs, you can still use the same thing. So if somebody else is installing it, it's fine. It's okay. It's a shared machine kind of a thing. And probably the advantage which...
Are you expecting people to use it at the same time also?
No, I don't see a need for it. I don't think there will be a need for it.
Yeah.
Very rare. I don't see that happening. Okay. So basically it will be... In fact, I could go with one machine for my team of 10.
Yeah.
Across the process and tech. But then they might install different things. So I don't want to confuse it. Actually, otherwise one is enough. And when I say it will be like once or twice a month, each person will know it. And if they want to, right, they can kind of schedule it and share it. I think it's a perfect case of things like for some use cases, you want a machine kind of a thing to do it, right? Mm-hmm. And probably I think the other thing which I can also see is this is one advantage. Like, let's say somebody is traveling out, okay? They have a phone with them, mm-hmm. right? They don't have to carry their laptop. Mm-hmm. Now, this Windows is a full-fledged thing.
Right. Yes.
So you can do your development. So the dev team could have all the dev tools on that.
Yes.
Now, wherever they go, typically today they have some tablet either for your kids or family, or you have a mobile phone.
Yeah.
Now they don't have to carry their laptops along. So that is another bonus that I would get, right? So when they're going out, just go. If there's any problem, we'll say, do I have to carry my laptop? That question is gone out of the window.
Yeah, tablet is good enough.
I think from a cost perspective, it seems slightly expensive if you kind of take a traditional laptop and I kind of divide it. Like, let's say it runs for 4 years, okay? And I get a very high-end laptop, okay? So the high-end laptop will be something like 120,000 rupees, right? Mm-hmm. Now, if I kind of split it across 3 years, it's going to be 40 or 4 years, right? It's going to be 30K each year. And here, if it's something like this works to around roughly 3,200, right? Something like close to 38K, 40K per month, I mean, per year, okay? Which is more expensive than actually buying it. But if I kind of look at it, if I have to give 2-3 for each one, okay?
No, I think what you need to also add to that is the operational cost of managing that that hardware, right? Which disappears in this scenario. So which we usually do not consider.
Which we do not consider. Yeah. But from a founder perspective, I will lose the appreciation cost, okay? The depreciation value, which kind of helps. So here it's going to be a clear OPEX. So there is no, so actually if I buy something for $120,000, okay, so I get depreciation value, okay? Mm. Now that's one bit which I haven't thought about, but because it's not going to be for a lot of people, it's not that big a difference. But let's assume I had...
But the convenience you get out of it, it is much more than
in my case, it becomes very easy. But if it's going to be like across the board, right? If for all the employees, I'm going to replace it with this cloud PC, then I have to think hard about it.
Yeah. One of the scenarios where actually it helps is where you have people working temporarily, right? So suppose you hire an expert or a contractor to do something specific, right? And you want control over the production of that output of that contractor, and you don't want to give them a laptop, but you still want to retain the IP. So instead of giving them a laptop, he says, okay, we are just provisioning a virtual PC for you or a cloud PC for you. And you do whatever you do there and just keep it there. You don't really have to worry about applying our policies to your laptop and managing the content the way we want it, or apply firewall, all those things, right?
And I think that pandemic kind of situation, right? Like, let's say there is a person who doesn't have a laptop, they have only a desktop, and they say, right, you know, we want to work from home for 2 months.
Right.
Bam, this problem solves it, right? Yeah, provision a cloud PC and give it to them, and then say, you know, you can... And I think one of the coolest things I liked in this is that usually when there's cloud PC, right, it's like you're not, what is the bandwidth that's needed? So in this case, if you have just the video bandwidth, right, you can be sure of that. But I think we might, if you want to do heavy duty internet applications, we might have to consider the GB limit consumption that's there.
No, actually, this is the one of the benefits, which is, suppose if you were to work remotely from home and you're downloading a 10 GB file to your desktop. If this 10 GB file were going to our data center in Microsoft, it will come in seconds, right? And you will see the results, and still it's your desktop, right? So you're managing it there. Right, so that value actually you can get much better if it's a heavy internet dependency, upload download kind of an application. The cloud PC can actually give you much more bandwidth because it is sitting in a data center.
No, it gives me more bandwidth, but yes. There's a danger that I might consume that bandwidth very quickly.
I do not know whether there's a limit on that. I do not know whether there's a specific limit on internet bandwidth consumption for the cloud PC.
There is. I have to understand the details of how much and what. There is a bandwidth limit on that.
Okay.
Now, so, I don't know what I'm not clear is. That came recently. I think they are working out the details. That came out recently, pretty recently, I think, last week or something.
Okay.
But I think... The thing is, like, if you exceed it, then what, right? Do you charge you for it, or they'll just
stop it or throttle it?
Yeah, so that's something that I don't know. We'll have to check. But yeah, so these are things. But I think overall, I think it gives a lot more options for me as an enterprise. It gives me a lot more flexibility. It's a good thing.
Venkat, you want to, now you heard quite a bit about what it can do, what it can't do, some limitations, some, do you think this has value to your kind of work as a startup?
So after listening to what are the advantages of having this kind of system? So I'm just thinking where I can be utilize this cloud-based desktop. because we have already distributed as a Windows system, and we do not. And I just wanted to understand, along with the desktop, and what are the add-ons I'm getting it, because for Office we are paying separately some amount. If this desktop comes with the with the package of Office also, like I might think of.
There might be packages. There might be packages where they are offering it with the Office also, right? So we do not know. So what you're seeing, what Kumaran showed before we started recording, what he showed was this is going to behave just like your laptop. You just bought a new laptop. It is going to behave exactly like that. You need to install software. You need to.
You get the web version of it. You get the web version of Office.
Web version of Office is included.
Yeah.
So there's some packages include some things, but assume that you got a laptop.
Okay. That's what I'm thinking. Where I can be placed for the system for our company. And I also as Kumaran has clarified, if you wanted to have a set up a different VM in our cloud, and we need to do a lot of configuration and maintenance needs to be done, those part completely eliminated here. That's the one advantage I'm seeing it here. And task wise, yes, it is slightly higher side, but I don't think so. Like that is much problem here, because
one benefit I can tell you. Yeah. One benefit I can tell you, which you can do is. You don't have to give physical hardware to your remotely working employees. So if you suppose today you hire somebody and that person is not able to come to office, or you cannot physically hand them over a laptop for whatever reason, right? They already have some kind of a tablet or some kind of a Mac or a PC. You can give them a standard developer environment very quickly, without, and they can be productive in quick time.
One thing, as you said, we can install everything in the cloud. We can give them access so that it will reduce the onboarding time. That is the one part. But thing is, what if you don't have some people will say, I don't have a laptop, I don't have anything, give
then
me
obviously,
something.
Then obviously, maybe, that so, is, then you have the option of giving them a cheaper hardware, right? So you don't have to expend on expensive hardware. The expensive hardware can sit in the cloud, the cheap hardware can sit on premises.
But I'm actually curious.
And right? Also,
have you had somebody who don't even have access to a tablet?
I did ask tablet, but one of my our employees, the newly recruited employee, said that I have only a wife laptop. Yes, she is working, and I don't have anything to work.
Okay.
Send me a laptop, then only I can start working. So that's what he said. And we it took almost 2 to 3 days to install and ship it. And remotely we have configured everything. That took some onboarding time. So that could have been this problem could not be solved there, because you don't have anything
physical
work.
Hardware. So
basically,
physical hardware.
In that case, I think I would actually say, if that is the case, right, I would actually send them a good 14-inch tablet with a keyboard.
Okay. So in that case,
it'll be
can
a simple,
the programmer? Yeah.
It'll be like a simple Android tablet.
Yes, okay. Of course. You can use it for, you can install Visual Studio on it. In fact, one of the options says you can install Visual Studio on it and get full performance. It's like regular hardware. So you want to give, you can give a lower end sort of a netbook kind of a PC, which can connect to a monitor or something like that. So you have both the things and that can have just like 2 GB, 4 GB kind of a configuration. All you need is good access to the internet.
Yeah, So will it also support graphics card as well? But that
it
could
does,
be very
it,
higher.
It does do graphics also. So in fact, the legacy of this product is in gaming actually. So this uses the same technology which there's a product called xCloud, right? Which is you can play Xbox games in the cloud. So if you don't have an Xbox but you have a lower end hardware, you can have a full fledged experience of Xbox on your tablet or a phone. So the background is that. So that it's built on that sort of technology. So you can do graphics also. So it does.
Okay.
To decent graphics.
Okay.
All right. So Nishant, do you think this is something which in your scenario, in your organization, you can find value in using something like a cloud PC?
Yeah, I found it very. First of all, I'm hearing this thing in this meeting, I found it very interesting and useful. Especially, I had scenario like. I had a travel to my hometown. Actually, I forgot to take my laptop. And there was a scenario like, I need to take my machine remotely. I have only a tablet. That time, actually, I was trying like to install some remote desktop, some kind of remote desktop client like application in my tablet, and I was trying to do, but all got failed. And this is, I think, one of the key aspects that you guys discuss is like, we can easily accessible this machine from the portable and handy devices. That is an important aspect. And the second thing is like, say if we have a startup plan or a startup idea and to just start with an organization with 3 or 4 employees, and from an infrastructure setting up point of view, if we have this ready-made options, that would be really adding value, especially in getting into a productive mode. Like we can purchase this, say 5 or 10 Windows cloud PC, and they can start working from the very next moment. So, and one query here is like, how about the LAN network kind of thing? Like, say if I have 5 members and I purchase the 5 license for this Windows PC, if one member has to share some files to other member's machine through a shared location.
So that's usually done through things like Office 365, where you have a sort of a SharePoint implementation where you can share whatever you have. Teams where you use to share, basically Teams runs on the SharePoint background. So you can put everything you want on those platforms. That is how it is done in real scenarios.
Okay.
More often than not. So that's nowadays I have rarely seen where people need to do a LAN sharing, right? So most sharing happens using Teams.
So in his case, I think it will. In his case, right? For example, it will be something like you have a Java server running on prem, and I would like to do a telnet into it.
Yeah.
That kind of a scenario, I think, Nishant, for that, right, what would happen is once you provision a cloud PC, right, there would be, typically there are two ways to bell that cat. One is on that machine, you do a VPN, and then using that VPN, you connect to your enterprise. That's one way of doing it. But if this is going to be an enterprise strategy, right, then you would actually create a LAN network in Azure and provision these on top of that.
Yeah, though the example I mentioned may not be the right one. The scenario like one member acting as a QA, the other member acting as a member who is deploying the things. Assume he's deployed the application is in his Windows 365 PC. Then how the other guy will go into access that?
Yeah.
Anyway, LAN record, right?
Yeah. So you see, those unique scenarios where you need physical access to that device for the QA to work on, that means that needs to be thought about. Means I've not thought about how that would function. But in usual scenarios, as Kumaran said, you make a sort of an enterprise level connection between your cloud PCs and your physical enterprise network. So at the Azure level, you will do such things, right? But to, I do not have the answer to your exact question, whether that will actually work the way you would actually do in way somebody was looking over your shoulder, right? So if QA were supposed to come and look over your shoulder and see, the only workaround I can see is you give access to your PC to that person and that does the remotely whatever you were doing, right? So that would sort of solve that problem.
Right. And how about the other guy deployed an application in his machine and I want to access that?
Yes. You see, it's just like you hand over your laptop to somebody else. So you have to give your laptop to somebody else. So unless that application is a network application, which you need to open ports and things like that. So then that becomes a little more complicated. But that is a sort of a client server kind of a model where you need to have a server sitting. So in that case, it is better to have a virtual machine sitting in the cloud and have manage it like a server, right?
Yeah. The another one is like the bandwidth utilization. I think we need to consider the bandwidth usage cost also when we.
Yeah. So actually, the bandwidth usage cost will be much lower in case of a remote desktop versus you working actually on your own laptop, right? Because all the data is in the cloud, all the data is going between the clouds. The only thing which is coming to your desktop is just the screen.
Right? Yeah, that's what my question also. And what is the minimum bandwidth you need to connect to the remote desktop?
So I think there's like some 2 Mbps or something.
It is like if you can watch a video, you can watch a movie on Amazon.
Yes,
that good bandwidth enough. Buffering, if you can watch a movie from wherever you are on Amazon, that is enough bandwidth. I think that's a very simple way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Without buffering, if you can watch a movie, you can use this without any problem.
And remember, movies have a much higher frame rate than if you're just using the desktop. A desktop will feel natural even if you have 15 frames a second, right?
Yeah.
Because as long as you move the mouse, you're just typing. 15 frames a second is good enough for typing and doing your regular work on your desktop. Unless you are watching video inside that, right? So then it becomes, your question was also that how do I use a camera with such an application?
Yeah.
So that actually does happen. Even if you today, if you have, I actually did it with my iPad. I have an iPad. I connected it to my desktop. So I wanted to do Visual Studio Code and there is no Visual Studio Code option available on iPad. So what I did was I set up RDP on my desktop and I use iPad to connect to my Windows machine. And the RDP client, which I need for iOS, gives you the option to get the microphone, the speakers and the camera to your remote. So it will create that virtual camera and will behave like exactly like as if you are using the PC camera.
Okay. So that is also possible. I thought that it's very difficult. Okay.
Yeah, no, that is very much possible, and I've used it successfully. I've done Teams meetings using my RDP to my Windows machine.
That's great. Actually, that's a great feature.
Okay, I think we got some good views on what are the possible scenarios, and all of us agree that this looks like like a good option for people to try. And so there are a lot of scenarios, especially in the pandemic, it is now made possible for people to be able to use something like Cloud PC. But going forward, I think this might become the future where people usually don't want to own physical desktops. They may want to keep it in the cloud. And once these services become available to consumers, today is targeted at businesses. Tomorrow, I may want a Windows machine, but I may not want a desktop to be sitting inside my home. I will just invest in a tablet and have a big machine sitting in the cloud somewhere, access it wherever I want. So that looks like something which is going
and
to happen.
Just to kind of give you a thing, right? As we were talking, I actually subscribe to it.
Okay.
So, and last question I just wanted to ask.
Yeah.
As a developer, and I would like to work in a big screen.
Oh yes. Okay. Oh yes.
So is it possible I can have a tab with a 17-inch monitor? Can I connect?
I think so. I think
yeah,
so.
Yeah, yeah.
I think so. It supports multiple okay. monitors also. Or you okay. can have a full big screen monitors itself. So
okay, so there is two. I think that's an interesting question. There are two possibilities there. One, get an external monitor that you can connect it to your secondary device, right? And then you put this whole thing there. But I think that other part, can I actually project a screen extension monitor? Yeah. We might need to. I'm not too. I don't know. We have to check that. That's a good question.
Because, consider this, sir, I have only tablet and monitor, so I just wanted to.
So tablet and a monitor, that I don't know. That depends on the capabilities of the tablet, if it can connect to. So a lot of tablets come with that micro HDMI. So if a tablet can connect to a TV, which is basically HDMI out, you should be able to achieve what you want, right? So if the tablet supports connecting an HDMI cable to a TV, you can connect it to a monitor also. So if that mini HDMI or whatever port is available, so that is usually the criteria.
If that could be done, then it would be
So as far as I know, iPads don't support connecting HDMI to TVs, but a lot of TVs, by the way, you can do something else. So there is there's a wireless connection to a display. So a lot of tablets actually support, even phones support a wireless connection to a TV. So if you have an Amazon Fire Stick or something, it has a option to connect your desktop. So I have done that actually a number of times. My Windows desktop, connect to a remote projector, it will show up your...
It's called screencasting.
Yeah, screencasting. You can cast a screen.
Okay, yeah. Screencasting can be done. Okay.
So tablets, that is another option. If you do not have that HDMI thing, probably you can do a screencast. But the stability of that connection and all depends on your Wi-Fi and things like that. It works, but there are some limitations. You have to live with that. Sometimes the screencast can be slower and faster, whatever. Those things you have to manage out. Right?
Yeah, one thing related to this, the same thing. Like, can we connect an external keyboard to the tablet?
Yeah, of course. A lot of keyboard, iPads have their keyboards, right? You can get a Bluetooth keyboard.
Yeah, connected. That is. My point is with the Samsung tablet kind
of thing. Oh yeah, you can. You just have to pair it with Bluetooth.
Yeah, Bluetooth keyboards are very common. Very common these days. Bluetooth keyboards and mouse. Now, earlier iPad did not support mouse. Now they are supporting mouse also.
Okay.
So you can connect a Bluetooth mouse to it. So I think this was a good discussion. It seems like there is good interest in this kind of a product, and I see that there is a lot of potential for people to stop using dedicated desktops. And when we say desktop, it is usually a Windows desktop, right? So nobody considers. I don't think Apple is going to ever make a cloud PC Mac, right? They have no intention of doing that. They want the hardware to be sold. Kumaran, you want to say something?
Amazon is doing something equivalent, but I don't know.
But they will support a Windows.
Right.
So they will support Windows. So that's what I meant to say. When you are looking for a desktop, what you're looking for is a Windows desktop. Nobody is looking for remoting to a Mac OS. Mac OS as a cloud PC. Maybe if Apple wakes up one day and thinks about that, they might do it. But today. When you think about remote desktops and working remotely, it's always Windows desktops. So I think we can conclude the discussion here. So thank you for listening, and thank you to Venkat, Kumaran, and Nishant for this lively discussion to a topic which we thought we'll spend 20 minutes. We spent nearly 45 minutes discussing it. So thank you, and please give us your feedback.